The Pi Connection Manager is invoked from most of the applications like Processbook and Datalink. In Processbook, it's under File Connections. You'll find it in Datalink under the Pi menu. Connections dialog here allows us to specify what the Pi server is, the default Pi server, and also to add new servers. So every installation of a client is going to, if there are no default servers already, it's going to prompt you what is your default Pi server. Whatever the installer answered, that's going to show up as your default server. In this case, it's just this phony Pi server here. Incidentally, this checkbox does two things. Not only does it indicate, but it also initiates a connection. In this case, that server doesn't exist, so the initiation of the connection fails. And that may well happen if you've got an installation in which they pointed to a server that doesn't actually exist. Now, I'm going to go ahead and add a new server. I'll choose Server, Add Server, and this is how you add a new Pi server. I'm going to go ahead and type in the network name. This was called OSIsoft.trng. It can be either the fully qualified domain name or just the local name, or it could even be the IP address if you prefer. Now, you are going to need to supply a few things with this. First of all, the username and any password that username may have. This is going to be the Pi username that you would associate with connecting, you know, the credentials you want to pass when you connect to this server. And as you can see, there's by default, it's Pi admin. Of course, in most systems, you should have a password for that. Now, in addition, you need to specify what a type of connection it is. Now, typically, it's going to be a Pi 3 connection. Only the very oldest of Pi servers out there are still the VMS-based Pi 2 connection. So for 99.9% of you, it's going to be Pi 3. So all you really need is the name of the computer and the user and the password that you're going to be connecting with. I'll go ahead and choose OK. Now, what I did was, when I did set that up, I chose the option here called Confirm, which goes out and actually tries to initiate a connection to verify that that server is actually there. So I'm pretty certain that when I click on this box here, it will not only select, but it will initiate the connection, and that should work properly. As you can see, it's currently disconnected. I'll go ahead and click on here, and that went ahead and connected me. It connected me as Pi admin, that user I specified. Now, in some organizations, you may have many, many different Pi servers, and you can use this connection dialog box to initiate the connection to each server. You can also use this to configure which is the default server. So if I go into Tools Options, you'll notice this is where I can specify what my default server is. I'm going to go ahead and switch it over to OSIsoft TRNG. And finally, you have the option to specify aliases for your servers. That option is within the server menu. It's called Server Aliases. Now, let me explain what this is all about. Normally, when you initiate a connection or configure a server, there is a 5-digit alias that we store internally with many of the different applications that make connections to that server. Processbook, for example, in the Processbook displays, you'll see embedded this 5-digit server alias. And it's just more efficient to do it that way than to embed the server name, especially if you go ahead and change the name of the server. Now, because people do change the name of servers, or sometimes they move these Processbook displays from one computer to another that's using a different server, maybe for the same organization, where they have parallel Pi systems but just on different servers, sometimes it's very useful to set up a brand new alias. So if I were to add an alias, or excuse me, if I were to find that my display is making reference to a 5-digit number that's not listed here, I could add a new 5-digit number. Let's just choose 12345, and that would be the number that the display is associated with, and then I can assign which server that alias will map to. Actually, 12345 is kind of a bad example. What I'm really saying is that if you've got existing displays that have aliases in them, or have these 5-digit numbers in them that do not, you know, are not the current 5-digit numbers you have for your Pi server, you can add an alias that will map that 5-digit number to your current server. So, you know, typically you would find the five digits is not going to be something simple like 12345. It's going to be a system-generated five-digit integer that's associated with whatever previous server that PI display was looking at. So by doing something like this, this ensures that any process book display that's looking for that particular server will find that server because it's now mapped to OSIsoft TRNG. Now you may wonder, how did this, you know, this series of events come to pass? It's basically the history of the software is such that, you know, during different upgrades of the client's applications, we found some legacy servers out there that were still in these displays, and so our support for those legacy servers comes through these server aliases. So you don't have to modify all of those client applications, those client displays. You simply have to add an alias to point to whatever that client application file was originally developed for. Now just a footnote, every once in a while you'll hear people talk about the known service table, the KST. The known service table is where we keep track of all the different servers that you see listed here.